folks, back again. Happy New Year on that subject. Happy New Year, what makes you happy? That's an interesting point that I had to think about a little while. I mean, I know I don't have much to be unhappy about. I have to work at it if I want to be unhappy. But I don't spend a lot of time doing that. But a lot of people are unhappy. They take pills to feel happier and yada yada. But the whole thing is, there are ways in the Word of God to be happy. And I want to share a few things with you today. Suleiman, he was he ruled the Ottoman Empire for donkey's years. And at one point in his life, after a certain building project, he was reputed to have said, "Ah, Solomon, I have surpassed you." The misery that characterized his later life was testimony to the fact that happiness does not come from riches or power. Jonah 4:6. Then the Lord God provided a vine and made it grow over Jonah to give shade for his head and to ease his discomfort. And Jonah was very happy about the vine. But at dawn the next day, God provided a worm which chewed on the vine so that it withered. When the sun rose, God provided a scorching east wind, and the sun blazed on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. He wanted to die and said, "It would be better for me to die than to live." I want you to notice something as we work through this stuff, right? Notice it says, and the Lord God provided a vine. The Lord God provided a vine. Now, this is the provision of the Lord. Are we to stop?
No.
This is the Lord's provision. So we sometimes think that God is only supposed to provide good stuff for us. But God is in the business of not necessarily making us happy in that respect, but making us happy from a holistic point of view, so that all of us gets over the line, not just the little bit, not just happy for a day, but a happy demeanor, a happy life, because we've learned to walk with God. Now, we belong to one of the richest nations, one of the most peaceful in the course of our normal life. Australia is the lucky country. It's a good place to live. I think you'll agree with me. Church is free. We don't, for the time being at least. And nobody messes with us. We live in a politically stable environment, although if you don't like the present government, you won't think you do, but we do. There's no punch-ups in Parliament. Environmentally, we haven't got many pollutants. You can go to the beach, and it's beautiful. And seismologically stable places. And although we had a 7.2 Richter earthquake in Northern Territory just recently, that's still just nothing. Now, Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 12, it says, "I know that there is nothing better for men than to be happy and do good while they live. And on to Ecclesiastes 5:19. Moreover, when God gives any man wealth and possessions and enables him to enjoy them, to accept his lot and be happy in his work, this is a gift of God. This is a gift of God. Isn't it nice that God allows you to work? Not too many people amen that one. That's because there's only three people in the entire building, but that doesn't... And on to Ecclesiastes 7:14. When times are good, be happy. Wrote a song about that, didn't it? But when times are bad, consider God has made the one as well as the other. Therefore, a man cannot discover anything about his future. We can't change the nature of things. The future will happen no matter whether we worry about it or not. Everything has its season. When things are not good for us, the preacher calls on us to reflect on the fact that not everything goes our way all the time. This is when faith and tenacity comes in. We come into this world usually crying. Some never stop dripping about something. Scripture tells us that God provided for Jonah both the vine and the worm. That's an important point. He provided both the vine and the worm. Vine's nice, worm's not, still God's provision. Because some people think that God has to supply everything good, nothing bad. That is not what the scripture says. We can get bad things happen to us, and while God maybe didn't put the bad things on us, we can learn from it. God is not in the business of raising spoiled brats. Rather, he has provided us with a probationary period, and it's called life. And in this life, the aim is to learn to live with me, because we are going to be together forever. Think about that, church. No matter where you go, I can be there. You lucky people. Here is where Paul's 1 Corinthians 13 love list kicks in. Love is patient. I'm going to need that one big time. Ecclesiastes 11:9. Be happy, young man, while you are young, and let your heart give you joy in the days of your youth. Follow the ways of your heart, but look after your dad. No, it doesn't say that, And whatever your eyes see, but know that for all these things, God will bring you to judgment. And it ends on a happy note. What a clever little man Ecclesiastes is. Life is finite. Thanks, Adam. Our bodies are subject to the fall. Nothing we can do about it. Our future is not subject to the fall. We have an endless hope and not a hopeless end. Christians are bought. Bought people. We belong to God. It is our responsibility to live a life which is in keeping with his word and his calling. Oh, I struggled with that, folks. I guess you might have noticed there were people doing things outside and it was very distracting. But there you are, we live in a society that allows other people to live. Very annoying. But we're stuck with it, so that's what we get. Anyway, blessings on you. Have a great week and live it for Jesus. Amen.
Hi guys. It's really great to be here, although I look around the building with it being so empty and think, oh God. But I understand that we live in a time that's been like no other. And we have the opportunity to share in that and be as effective in the kingdom as we possibly can at this time. And, you know, it's proving to be particularly difficult for David to actually look up and look at the camera and then look down and find your place on the laptop and then look up and look down. And so that can be very, very difficult. If you're not a teacher and you just preach, it can be a lot easier because you don't have the in-depth notes that come with teaching. And so with David's stuff, it's word perfect from his angle, and each sentence means a lot and carries a lot. And so it's a hard time for him, but pray for him that we'll get there anyway. I don't have the same difficulty at the moment because I don't have any notes to go with and look up and look down and so on and so forth. So it's a completely different gifting and a completely different role. But I just want to quickly share with you what you already know, and you would say, why bother? Because if I don't repeat it and we don't keep looking at it, we will miss what God would have in these final days. As I sat on the deck this morning, I asked the Lord what would he have me say with regard to COVID and what's happening and the role of the church. And I have put the prayer people into a situation where they're not stopping praying, but we've been coasting through that holiday break because everybody, unless we have massive emergency, everybody needs a little bit of a break. But now as we've come out of that time, I'm wanting to bring the speed up and have us just start to connect at a higher level so that we can be obedient to God. And as I had you all on my heart, because I know that we had to cancel a prayer meeting as well, and that was on the boards, but it was too dangerous. I know that a lot have prayed. Some maybe not, but they'll catch up as we go. But I also want to extend the challenge to you guys that are not in the prayer group and that don't pray very much at all, because I don't want you to miss out on what God's going to do in this time. You know, we long for revival and we long to see the next move of God, but we are in a current thing that God will and is using for his glory, but we're also in a current time where a lot of people are grieving and a lot of people are going through a tough time. So I said to the Lord, what would you have me? And he took me to, I believe it's a scene, and I often talk about movies with things when the Lord shows me stuff because I'm a visual person. And I went to what I believe is Braveheart by Mel Gibson. And in it, as you know, it's all the old weapons and the bows and the axes and the swords. And it's towards the end of the movie, I believe. I could be wrong, but this is kind of what the Lord showed me and how to apply it. It might be a completely different movie. I kind of added the Mel Gibson because it seemed likely. But I saw a huge, long row of people. And they were warriors. They were kitted full out for battle. They'd been in battle for a long, hard time, and things were wearing, and they were pretty well worn out. And coming, and they were all on this their swords raised and the shields in front of them, and they were waiting for the enemy to come over the hill. And my impression was this was the final battle. Does that click anywhere with where we are at now? We're coming into the final battle. The one that God's going to use us to touch another generation for Jesus. And this battle was a big enemy army that were going to come over the hill. And the likelihood of this other group winning was pretty tough. And there's a voice from like a Mel Gibson person who's leading the group, and he says, hold still, hold the line, stand still. And as I look, there's pressure on the warriors, and the bows are creaking. And the group is coming against them. And they're getting closer and closer, and they're fixed with their arrows. And the leader's saying, hold still. And God says to us, the people of prayer, hold still right now. Let the tension be in your heart and life for the kingdom. Pay attention and hold your line. But don't fire an arrow yet. Wait for the call. What does that mean? And how does that manifest? I don't know, except to say to you that God is going to use us in a way that will deal with the enemy. Now, as I look around, I suddenly see off to my right, in a corner, there's some tents and other soldiers wandering around, and there are people having something to eat and other people just wandering off, taking their ease. And the Lord said, you shouldn't be at your ease in this season. If anything, you should be ill at ease. Because we're about to take a battle on at the next level. So get your priorities right. Get your focus right. You may not know how to do. You might not feel, I don't know what to do with the sword, which is the word of God. How do I get the Bible to deal with stuff? If you will take your time out at this time and wait on him, he'll help you to become part of that line. But it's coming anyway. So choose the right decision. I believe the days where we come and do our own thing and do as we want will go. The things that the vaccination have brought in, and the mandates and the difficulties and the protests, about the beginning of an unholy rule that's going to come upon the place. And it's not going to be like it ever was. Because things are changed in political places that will affect us. Don't be led by your emotions or your feelings, but be led by the Word of God. So pick up your sword of the Spirit. Pick up the Word of God and hear what he says. Let him retrain you and then get on the line. For those on the line in prayer, he's saying the time is not quite yet. So just ease off the pressure just a little bit and learn to carry the weight of standing in the gap and thanking him for mercy. As you continue to delight in him, you'll be able to carry long-term the responsibility of being part of that final group. That's a time. Don't put the arrow and bow down and go off and do your thing? Not allowed if you're going to be part of it. Come aside. Stand ill at ease with your bow and your arrow ready, with your sword up, with your shield. I pray we don't lose one. So that in this final time, you know, God can snuff out Omicron like that. Maybe as he says to us, go, and gives us a word, the whole thing will dissolve. What do we know? Some of you might feel that you just start fasting and praying. If you've got that on your heart, start that. We may possibly go into some more of that, but it's not quite yet. So guys, let's get ready for the biggest fight of our life. Let's get ready to share in this momentous times and then see people come to know Jesus. The other side of it, we see in a horrible valley, and I think it's called Jezreel, is that right, David? Where the bodies are slaughtered and people go to hell. It's got to bother us. We want them all on Jesus' side. So get stuck into praying for the unsaved. Get stuck into witnessing about the unsaved so that we can see more come with us than go the other way. So thank you for listening to me. You might not. You might switch me off. Or that's your prerogative. but we'll give you more updates as time goes on. Carefully, with due detail, pay attention to what he would say. Bless you guys.
Walking on this road so long, still can't see the end. Gotta put up a fight, I ain't gonna lie, when doubt starts creeping in, questioning every step, regretting all my mistakes, but I can't forget without these steps, I wouldn't be here today. Hallelujah, blessed, for this journey I'm on, cause with every step, joy in your stress, another step closer to home.
Another step closer to home. Hallelujah, blessed, blessed, God, for this journey.
closer to home. I said another step closer, another step closer, another step closer to home.